Great. Okay, so thank you, Scott, for the intro. I'm an operational geophysicist at the USGS Cascades Volcano Observatory. Our office is in Vancouver, Washington, and we monitor major volcanic centers throughout Washington and Oregon. And so I'm going to be discussing a dramatic expansion of our monitoring capabilities around Mount Rainier. I'm going to focus a lot on the context and background of this project. I think the history is interesting. But a quick summary is that we've installed, since 2016, we've installed 25 modern seismic monitoring and seismoacoustic, actually, monitoring stations around Mount Rainier. And the primary focus is lahar detection, which Avery did a great job of introducing the risk at Mount Rainier. So I'm going to expand on that and talk about some of the work that we're doing. Next slide, please. So Rainier has had dozens of eruptions in the last 10,000 years, and Avery showed a very similar map of large lahars that have originated at Mount Rainier. And so these massive mud flows have two primary potential triggers. One is volcanism rapidly melting the glaciers and snow on the mountain. And the other potential cause is a rapid collapse or avalanche, if you will, of hydrothermally altered weak rock on the mountain. And there are multiple cities built on these deposits. Actually, if you can click through the bullets really quick. Forgot that those were animated. And one more click, please. So there's multiple cities that are built on these historic lahar deposits. And I want to point out the town of Ording, which was built on the electron mudflow, which occurred about 500 years ago, and which Avery mentioned as being one that didn't have, that we haven't found co-eruptive activity for. And this realization is really what inspired work that began in the 1990s to develop a lahar detection system at Rainier. Next slide, please. So beginning actually in the 1950s and 1960s, USGS scientists realized that deposits that extended all the way to Puget Sound that were thought to be glacial in origin were actually lahar deposits from Mount Rainier. Rainier gets to be the first volcano where we have a comprehensive hazard map that was developed, which you can see on the bottom right. So this hazard was recognized pretty early. Next slide, please. And to further understand the hazard, work continued with geologic mapping, dating of deposits of eruptions, and then tracking the origins from lahar deposits. This helped build a timeline of eruptions in lahars at Mount Rainier. Can you one click, please? And this is showing near the left eruptive periods at Mount Rainier in the last 10,000 years. And then closer to the right, we have large lahars that have occurred. And in many cases, when there are eruptions, there have been lahar deposits found. And conversely, lahars usually happen when there are eruptions. But as Avery mentioned, one more click, please. The electron mudflow, which was only about 500 years ago and was quite massive, there haven't been any coincident tephra deposits detected for that lahar. Next slide, please. So this is an image of Ording taken in the early 1990s. We're facing east in this photo. Ording is bounded by the Carbon River to the north and the Puyallup to the south. And this picture is actually reminiscent of some photos of Armero in Colombia, a town that was destroyed in the early 1990s by a lahar. Next photo, please. And it's actually kind of been difficult to deny the dramatic geologic history in Ording. When the town was being developed, there are massive boulders and tree stumps that were carried to the area by the electron mudflow that were unearthed during development in the area. Next slide, please. So one challenge is understanding the geography of the current hazard. If a lahar were to occur, where would it come from and how big would it be? So there was work done combining geologic mapping and some geophysical imaging that helped characterize where the strong and then hydrothermally altered or weak rock exists on Mount Rainier. And the weak conditions exist only on the upper west slope of the mountain. All of the weakened regions on the east side were lost in past lahars. And this doesn't mean, especially given the extent of the glaciers at Rainier, that the east side could not experience lahars. It's just less likely to occur without volcanic unrest. And so if you'll note a couple key features here, the Sunset Amphitheater, again, we're facing east in this image. So this is the west face of the volcano, Sunset Amphitheater on the north, and the Tahoma Cirque Glacier to the south are considered potential source regions for a large devastating lahar. The Pauk Glacier and Tahoma Glacier respectively empty into their drainages. Okay, next slide, please. So in the last few decades at CBO, as more of our work to understand these lahars progressed, Dick Iverson and David George developed a very complex 4D model called DCLAW to help us understand and characterize landslides and debris flows. And so it does require inputting a source geometry and volume, and then it estimates things like flow velocity and depth over time. Running this model for Mount Rainier, for example, just one time takes days to weeks. It's very complex. So I'm going to show you a couple examples of this model for the regions that were identified by that geologic and geophysical mapping. So first, we're going to look at a large lahar initiating in the Sunset Amphitheater region. It's considered a very high volume or potential worst case scenario. Next slide, please. So this is just showing the first minute or so in this model of a lahar originating in that region. And so we have questions at this point about where is this lahar going to go, how fast is it going, and what areas downstream might be impacted. Next slide, please. So now I'm going to show a time progression of the lahar. Shown here are the upstream branches of the Puyallup River and the Mowich River, which come together at a confluence downstream. So this is 2 minutes after the initiation of the lahar, and it's already traveled close to 10 kilometers. At this point, it's near the national park boundary. Next slide, please. At this point, 10 minutes in, it's reached the confluence of the Mowich and Puyallup, and it's well onto the resource management property west of the park. Next slide, please. Continues to flow. Next slide. So at about 30 minutes, we reach Lake Powson, which was actually formed by the electron mud flow. And at this point, we're starting to really impact infrastructure. There's a highway through there in some population. Okay, next slide. Next slide. So at about 50 minutes, this lahar in this scenario has reached the town of Ording. Next slide, please. And then begins to fill in that river valley. So it's a massive volume of material that's traveled very far downstream. So this is a scenario where we would want to have warning that this could be occurring as early as possible. Next slide, please. This scenario is a similarly sized lahar originating in a source region a little bit more to the south in the Tahoma Glacier Cirque. Next slide, please. So you can kind of tell off the bat that this travels primarily down drainages that are a little bit more on the south and southwest flanks of the mountain. Next slide, please. So at 2 minutes in, the flow is already reaching park infrastructure. And the west side road in the national park is closed to vehicle traffic, actually due to damage from debris flows in the past, similar to some of the ones that Avery showed. Next slide, please. So there's still impact to the north in the Mowich and Puyallup drainages, but the flow is actually traveling quite a bit slower. Meanwhile, at just 10 minutes in, this flow has reached the Nisqually Park entrance. Next slide, please. And about 20 minutes has reached the town of Ashford. Next slide, please. And next. One concern in the case of a lahar originating in this region would be potential impacts on Alder Lake, which is a dammed lake downstream near Elby. Next slide, please. And next slide, please. So again, this lahar is much slower and less volume is traveling in the northern drainages and reaching the town of Ording. but still impacts can be seen there. Next slide. So in the 1990s, because of recognition of this hazard, the original Rainier lahar detection system was installed by CBO in Pierce County on major drainages leading to Orting. The sensors that were used are called acoustic flow monitors. They're basically really limited frequency seismometers, very simple versions of the instruments that Avery showed, and they were transmitting an average seismic amplitude every 2 to 10 minutes. These were attached to physical tripwires that would break if there was a big lahar moving down the channel. Data transmission was slow, and not a lot of information was conveyed other than confirmation of, yes, there's a lot of ground shaking, or no, there's not. This information was transmitted to emergency management locations in Tacoma and Olympia. And part of this was developing a robust algorithm, which is still in use today, that looks for these long duration, high amplitude seismic signals, and also looks for one broken tripwire signal. And that combination of factors would indicate the detection of a large lahar. Next slide, please. So that was in the mid-1990s, and in 2014, Pierce County began to work to request congressional funding for CBO to install a more modernized system. So a subset of that funding request was realized in 2017, and CBO determined that the ideal equipment for this would be much more advanced broadband seismometers, the type that are used for earthquake location detection. They track ground motion in 3 dimensions, and they're extremely sensitive instruments. And the idea with the modern system is to transmit continuously in real time, buying minutes of detection time in the event of a lahar. And we are actually transmitting data 50 times per second. Next slide, please. Oh, go ahead and click through the bullets. Another modern piece of equipment that we've incorporated is infrasound. So this is a low frequency microphone. So think about sound below the level that your ears can detect, but these can be really big acoustic waves that are generated by big mass movements. And in low wind conditions, these instruments have actually been shown to not only detect, but actually track lahar movement above ground. Okay, next photo. We cover these with windscreens to minimize that wind noise. So that's what it looks like installed. Next slide, please. So the installation of these stations is more involved than the AFM sites. The seismometers have to be buried underground so that they aren't overwhelmed by ground surface noise, like trees in the wind and elk walking by. Next slide, please. So all this equipment requires power and infrastructure to transmit data in near real time. So outside park boundaries, we're on resource management property with a combination of road and foot access. We require solar power and batteries to keep equipment running. So we build our so-called stations. These are basically giant tinker toy sets. They can be carried short distances and assembled on site. And the enclosures hold the batteries and sensitive electronics. Next picture. So we've installed 11 of these sites on the lands west of the park, and we've co-located 2 stations with infrastructure in Ashford and Elby. Next slide. Beginning in early 2020, we began work on compliance to request installation of new stations in Mount Rainier National Park, so much further upstream. And where possible, we co-located with park infrastructure to minimize disturbance. We worked closely with the park to determine the minimum requirements of the network for detecting lahars, and also determine the minimum tools for installation and maintenance in these sensitive areas. And after a thorough environmental assessment, in 2022, we completed installation of 12 new monitoring stations in the park boundaries. Next slide. And the infrastructure for these stations is a little different. We're at high elevation places, areas with really high snow loads. All right, I'm getting the stop symbol. Scott, would you? My timer says I have another minute.
If you could just try to wrap up in the next minute or so, that'd be great.
Okay, next slide, please. So this is what our network of monitoring stations looked like in 2015. And these stations are mostly actually maintained by the University of Washington Pacific Northwest Seismic Network. Next slide, please. And this is the network as it looks today. So with 25 new stations installed, and then in gray, you can see proposed locations for new installations. Next slide, please. So if we zoom into the Puyallup and Mowich drainages and show that progression of a modeled lahar, you can see that in 2015, we only had 3 sites near those drainages, whereas now we have much more station density, allowing not only earlier detection potentially, but potentially tracking and characterizing a lahar as it travels. Next slide, please. And this is showing a similar layout of our network as it used to be with the 3 blue sites and now with the red sites along the Coutts and Tahoma drainages. Next slide, please. There we go. And we've demonstrated some really neat capabilities with these sites. One of our permanent stations near Mildred Falls really picks up snow avalanches in that area quite well. And the infrasound sensors at that site can actually be used to track the back azimuth or approximate location of travel of those snow avalanches. And so the approximate direction from our site is shown in the map with those lines. Next slide, please. And finally, the debris flow that was shown by Avery as detected by our network of stations. A much smaller debris flow in 2019 when we had a very sparse network was detected by one station, but we really didn't have the ability with one station to characterize it. Whereas that 2023 debris flow with our much denser permanent network, post-processing, we were able to actually sort of track the progression of that lahar. And the hope is to build these capabilities and the capabilities that the Avery and others are working on developing through their work into more real-time algorithms in the detection system. Next slide, please. So thank you for attending today. We're really excited about the capabilities this expanded network is helping us realize. We're moving into long-term maintenance phase, and there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work happening to test some of these more advanced capabilities for real-time tracking and build those eventually into our algorithms. And the last slide. Right. Just want to acknowledge all the people and collaborations it requires to make something like this happen. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Rebecca. Unfortunately, we don't really have any time for questions. So if you do have a question for Rebecca, please put it in the chat. And Rebecca, maybe you can address those questions directly in the chat.
I'd be happy to.